Hello, and welcome to the Grace Fellowship podcast, where we gather together to have discussions about spreading God's fame and making disciples of Jesus Christ. I'm your host, Pastor Zach Watson, and today, instead of having to have two other pastors with me, I only need one pastor to be able to cover everything. He's that significant, that amazing. Joining me today is Pastor Drew Pierce. Hey, Drew.
Howdy, howdy.
Thanks for being here. We'll have some fun today, a little bit of a different format, and see if our attention spans are able to stay together in such a way to keep your attention.
I'll try to live up to your compliments.
Yes. I have no doubts. No doubts at all. You know what it's like? It's like Goose and Maverick is what it is.
There you go.
Although...
Which one am I?
Well, I was going to say, what do we do dibs on? I'd be interesting to know. At the end, stay tuned. Will you think about which one of us would rather be Goose and which one of us would be Maverick? And we'll see if we agree or if we have to fight over at the end. Because there's benefits to both. And if you don't know what we're talking about, first of all, shame on you. But obviously, from the classic Top Gun, right? You know, but anyway, we're dating ourselves a little bit there. Anyway, food for thought. We'll move on. We'll roll into it. We like to start here with a scripture reading. Remember, if you're watching on YouTube or if you want to go to YouTube, in the description, there's a little link there that's got a weekly packet. They'll give you like some devotional material, some additional resources that you can look into about this particular topic. It's down there in a little doodly hoodly in the description, a little blue link. All right. Well, what we like to do with this is we like to start by reading a text, a piece of scripture here to give us some context for what we're looking at. Of course, we'll go over many others. And today I'm going to read through Hebrews 4, verses 14 and 16. They say, "Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." And the reason I picked that verse is because it's one of the few ones that actually talks about the two attributes we're talking about today in that functional way. We're talking today about grace and mercy. I think often, maybe people don't think about the distinction between these two. They're twins, right? In a sense, they're very closely related.
Yeah, they go together.
Yeah, but there is a different way in which they manifest, in which they work out in our experience of who God is. So, Drew, start us off by helping us understand those concepts, those terms. What are we talking about when we're talking about grace and mercy?
So, the simplest way to understand grace is to think about that you have favor that you don't deserve, that you didn't do anything to earn. And then specifically, this is favor from God for you. That you didn't earn. And so we see things like in Romans 5, we see that Paul tells us that we were enemies of God, and yet Christ died for us, and then that becomes an example of the grace that God meets out to us through his Son. And so it's this idea that we were shaking our fist at God, we were in rebellion, and yet he had this kindness toward us that said, you know what, you're going to be mine, and I'm going to show compassion, I'm going to show mercy to you, which is our other word. Like, they really go hand in hand, but it's this idea that God gives us something that we don't deserve.
Yeah, that's really good. I mean, it's a proactive manifestation of God's goodness and his love towards us, right?
Absolutely.
He's extending something to us that we couldn't ever earn or deserve, which is interesting. I think, by the way, what we deserve kind of leads to defining what mercy is, right?
Yeah.
So what's the flip side of that mercy?
So, I mean, that's the other side, which, you know, another, you could think of some synonyms that you see in the Bible as compassion, pity. It's this idea of meeting another's need, especially when they didn't deserve for you to meet their need. So both sides have that undeservedness. And then it could be a physical need, because that's referred to as mercy at times in the Bible, you know, helping out someone who is injured or sick. But specifically, when we talk about the mercy we receive from God, it's primarily about the fact that he has met our need of being right with him through his Son, Jesus. And so we deserve punishment for our sin, and yet God has forgiven, which is an act of mercy.
Yeah. I mean, it's the idea that when we talk about deserves again, right? In this case, you do deserve something.
Yeah.
You deserve wrath. You deserve punishment. and his mercy is applied, which stops that extension of
absolutely.
It. So still a proactive manifestation of it, but in a different way. All right. So the one thing, guys, we talked about before this podcast, this is not going to be as organized because these attributes are really manifested and seen in God by how they're mediated out to us
right.
and how he works in the world. One of the things we talked about was there's not a need for mercy to be extended within the Godhead. Right? Yeah. It's always existed and was always there, but Christ didn't need to be merciful to the Spirit or anything. Everything there is merited.
Right? Absolutely.
So we'll get a little bit sloppy in how we move through our progression of our outline, but I think if you guys stick with this, you'll understand why we're doing it that way. So what are some implications about mercy and grace that we see within Scripture for who God is? How does that, how we learn about his character in that?
So the main thing that I came to thinking about that, and I know you and I have talked about this a bunch, it's been on my mind a lot lately, is the way that the Lord describes himself to Moses. So in Exodus 34, you have this incredible moment in this story where Moses has gone up to the mountain to meet with God. Meanwhile, the Israelites are down on the ground making a golden calf. You get the classic Aaron moment. I just threw something in there and it came out. Well, that's when he comes back down. But anyway, and so that's important for the context because what we see is that God has, we've been talking about God's simplicity. He has all these attributes and he holds them kind of at the same time, even if they seem to be in tension with one another. Moses says he wants to know God. He wants to see him. And so the Lord passes before him, and then he tells him about himself. And so Exodus 34, verses 6 and 7, it says that he passed in front of Moses, and he proclaimed, the Lord, or Yahweh, Yahweh. He says his name. This is who I am. The compassionate, or you could say merciful and gracious God. Okay, what does that look like? Slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. And then verse 7, maintaining that love to thousands and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. This is going on right now down at the foot of the mountain, and God says, I'm going to forgive that. Yet, he doesn't leave the guilty unpunished. It says he punishes the children and their children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation. And so I think it's really helpful for us to see kind of that tension that there is a justice of God that must be met. And so if you know the rest of the story, most of Israel is spared, but not all of it. Yeah. And I think we're supposed to take from implication from some of the other things happening that those who were not spared perhaps were not repentant. Mm. I'm reading between the lines a little bit, but I don't think too much.
Yeah. I know you don't think too much. It's one of the things I love about you.
but yeah, so you have this idea that God's holding these things that seem to be in tension, and he says, these are both who I am. But specifically, the mercy and grace, it's slow to anger, abounding in this faithful love where I love you despite your sin. I love you no matter what, and that means I'm going to forgive wickedness and rebellion. It's really something else to think about. This is who God says he is.
Yeah. That's what I think is important that we lose so many times when we think, which so frequently to lose in our culture, this idea of name. So like when he's saying like, this is my name, he's not simply meaning title, which is how we typically think of things, right? He's saying, this is what represents me, right? That's what we almost have to get old school to kind of think about that more, like wearing a crest or something like that, or the reason you have a last name, right? It's the representation of this clan and association. So when God says, this is who I am, and this is the description he gives, mercy, grace, still going to hold through with justice and all. And you use that word tension, which I think is a good word to use when we're thinking about it. But one of the things that's really cool to think about how there is a lack of tension within the Godhead.
For God, it's not tension. For us, it is as the observers.
Yeah, which makes us go, you're awesome. So awesome. So we could camp out on this verse like endlessly. This is probably, I just feel weird saying this, like, you have a favorite Bible verse. But if I am to find a place where I need to go back and back, regardless of what the circumstances are, whether or not it's good, joy, pain, sorrow, whatever, I find myself cracking over Exodus 34.
I come back to this all the time lately. Yeah. So
I think about like, this is part of even when Christ is on the cross enduring for the joy set before him, right? And he talks about in John 17 about that unity that I've had with you from forever. He's looking forward to this being with this wonderful and beautiful God, which doesn't even think about on the cross, the extension of grace and mercy being extended there with wrath,
Yeah. Right? In the midst. Like, yeah. Again, that tension, that perceived tension yeah. at the same time.
Which is really good. Because those things, like, they can't exist without the other.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Like, if there's not a need for punishment, if you don't deserve punishment, well, grace doesn't exist.
Yeah.
You know, there's no need for mercy if you don't deserve it. There's no need for favor if you already have owned it within and of yourself.
Yeah.
So it's good stuff, man. All right. I'm getting Twitter notifications here on my scripture. Note to everybody, you want to turn off all of your iPad notifications in your scripture. You don't want to hear about Ruth Bader Ginsburg doing something when you're reading Exodus 34. Maybe you do. Maybe that's you. I don't want to judge, but I don't know about that. All right. Well, let's see. Let's move on here into looking at how we see this in particularly in the life of Christ, talking about Christ on the cross. I mean, I think it's been said that these are the manners in which you see Jesus walk when he's on the planet. It is such a so identifiable with his nature. What are some particular ways that we saw this in Christ?
I mean, so you have the idea of Jesus extending mercy, particularly to those who society looked down upon. So in that time, that was people who were poor, people who were sick, disabled, right? And Jesus goes out of his way to show them God's mercy. And it's amazing because he does this out of an overflow of who he is, but then they respond, right? These people respond in worship, in following him. They see his goodness. They see his mercy. And then they follow him. But yeah, you have those examples of healing people and even bringing people into his inner circle who shouldn't be there,
yeah.
right? So you think about like Matthew, the tax collector, right? He's a sellout to Rome.
Yeah.
And Christ says, you know what? You're going to come and follow me too. You're going to be part of this group. And so kind of it's God's mercy in those moments is even doing the work of reconciling people to one another in the midst of, you know, pouring out his love. It's kind of amazing.
Thought about that before with the integration of the different types, because you think about
Simon the Zealot,
yeah,
Matthew the tax collector. Yeah. Like this guy wants to like literally kill the other guy.
Yeah. Right? Yeah.
And Jesus says, you know what? I am going to bring you in together. And we're going, because it's not about Rome, and it's not even really about the Jewish nation. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, it's about me.
Yeah,
That's really good. It's kind of amazing.
He creates a brood where there has to be mercy.
Yeah.
And then just the selection of each one of them is grace.
Oh, right? Absolutely.
There's no reason that they deserved selection into this inner circle.
No.
So it's unmerited favor again and again.
And I think if you look at kind of a lot of those interactions that we see with specific members of that group, like especially Peter, right? Mm-hmm. You know, he's kind of strong-headed. You would look at that and go, well, that guy does not deserve to be part of this crew, right? Mm-hmm. Like, he's publicly rebuking his teacher at times.
Yep.
He cuts off a guy's ear, you know, just out of, you know, he's just so riled up. You have all these kind of moments, and then he denies Christ, and yet Jesus used him immensely after the resurrection.
Yeah.
So it's that grace being poured out over and over that he didn't deserve.
Yep. It's such a quintessential element. Like it's almost a silly question to ask, because particularly if you go through and you read the Gospels, and even if you want to read the Revelation without trying to get all Bible code or whatever on it, and seeing Jesus in this vindicated return, there's just constantly grace and mercy, grace and mercy, grace and mercy.
Oh yeah.
Which it kind of has to be. He's manifest God interacting with human. He has to condescend. Like there's no other,
right.
It has to be the modus operandi. There's no other way to function.
Well, you know, thinking about the Revelation, even in the midst of, you have the, those who've been killed for their faith, yeah. right. And those who've been murdered, and they're crying out, just like, Abel's blood cried out in Genesis 4. And you know, how long? And Jesus says, you know, I'm coming, I'm going to make it right. That in and of itself is an act of mercy for those people who've been wronged.
Yeah.
So even the meeting out of justice is an act of mercy for those who have received injustice.
Yeah. Again, you can't separate them, right?
Yeah.
It's the idea of the, so I like there's this ice cream that you get, it's called Rebel, and it's got a lot of fat in it. And I found this really good flavor. It's like an almond swirl thing. The problem with this ice cream is it's so frozen that you have to like let it thaw and then mix it up and then let it refreeze again or whatever. And don't, you cannot get that swirl effect. You know, like if you have swirl ice cream and right. you taste it. Once you mix it, you can't get it away.
It's just all one thing.
Yeah. I mean, we just lost all the non-ADDers out there, but it's all right. For those of you that are like us, you have a home here. But the idea of like the idea of justice, mercy, wrath, grace, you can't separate them. They're always being being manifested out in the way that we are interacting with the Lord, which is so fundamentally great. Like I think, and this is where I'm gonna blur the outline a little bit here and go into the wrong section, but I think that we're too quick to forget that every interaction that we have in our life is God's mercy to us.
Absolutely. Right? Yeah.
When we talk about deserving death, Romans, right? The wages of sin, you have earned death, right? We were born into death. That's what we deserve. So the fact that you are not being smote is mercy, right? The heartbeats that we've been having right now, your ears working right now to hear this, or your eyes seeing this and your body functioning, all of that is not entitled. You're not entitled to those things, right? The Declaration of Independence is kind of a falsehood, right? You're not inalienable rights. Life and liberty are things that the Lord gives to us that we are not entitled to, and we can kind of forget that. But when you read through and look at the life of Christ, and you even look through epistles, you look through the Old Testament, you see the way God interacts, you're like, that is all of life. Life is covered in mercy and a constant grace, right?
Even the garden, right? So the day you eat of it, you will die. Yeah. You will die. You will surely die. And then God instead kills an animal, covers them. They have to leave the garden, but their life is preserved. And then the same thing happens with their son in Genesis 4 when he kills his brother, right? He should be smoked on the spot, and God instead makes a way for him to stay alive and to be preserved. And so it's over and over again, just the simple fact that we breathe every morning is God's mercy to us.
You see it through the Bible. I mean, you can keep going through the biblical epic, and you see, like, we've been talking a lot in our house about the flood recently. Just the boys are getting more into science and stuff like that, and some of the interesting stuff that they've been discovering in creation science. Sorry if that's a trigger for some people, but check it out. When you see that idea of Noah, you think this is right now the way that we've seen and experienced the greatest expression of God's wrath. The greatest expression of God's wrath was on the cross, but that's not something that we see the ramifications of now. But you can you can see ramifications of the flood. You can go to the Grand Canyon, or you can go to the hills just up here in North Georgia, and you can see those kind of things. And you think, man, all of that justice and wrath. The story is about the ark. It's not the story is about the Lord. But what we're talking about is this idea of God's mercy being extended. Yeah. It wasn't like Noah, like God was looking out and it says, you know, he found this righteous guy that was like, oh, I have to let Noah live. Right?
Right.
Like Noah wasn't as bad as the other people, by the way, because of what God did in him and gave him the faithfulness that he had. But it's an expression again of his mercy and his grace, which again is thinking us about when the Lord returns and there is the second destruction of the world, again, it'll be this huge display of amazing wrath and justice and vindication that we will think about primarily as mercy and grace to us, right?
Right.
So, so good. Good stuff. All right. Well, at this moment, we're going to say it's going to get weird here because we're going to be all over the place the second half, but we're talking about the question of the day, which is, how does this impact your life? So like if you're in YouTube land out there, in the comments below, let us know how you've thought in your life about how grace and mercy have impacted your life, or how you see them impacting your life. Maybe it could be a testimony from like your salvific experience, or even something you just seen recently. We'd love to see those comments if you're willing to share. They're really encouraging, I'm sure, to other people who might see them. But Drew, and I'll answer this question as well, but how do you see this attribute having an impact in your life?
So the first thing that came to my mind thinking about this was in Romans, when Paul makes the turn from, here's all this information, now here's what you should do. Mm. So that's chapter 12, right? He says, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy. And so in view of all these things that I've just told you about that are expressions of God's mercy, this is what you should do. And he says, you need to offer yourself as a living sacrifice. And so for me, like, takes me back to Jesus telling the disciples that they have to pick up their cross and follow him. It's this idea of Philippians 2, right? Mm-hmm. Considering others as more important than yourselves. So when I see God's mercy in my life, that he has not given me what I deserve, mm-hmm. and his grace, that he has poured out favor on me that I don't deserve, what I'm supposed to do with that is then take it and yield my wants and my preferences, my very existence to the good of others, right? To extend to, so now I'm going to re-extend mercy mm-hmm. and grace to other people. And so, you know, that's real practical if you live in a house with other sinners, right? And, or if you happen to be the chief of sinners in your house.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Right? And so, but seriously, that's like, so that's where my mind went was, okay, God has been merciful to me. He's been gracious to me. And so I need to sacrifice. I need to die to myself. Mm. And so, you know, when I'm supposed to be working and there's a ton of noise in my house, which is most of the time, you know, thank you, COVID. like, I don't need to insist upon my rights,
mm-hmm.
you know, that not that we don't necessarily have standards for our homes. We do. But that there's a way that you interact with your family that esteems their desires, esteems their needs above your own. And so you can have those conversations in a way that honors them and honors their feelings and preferences on whatever it is. And in my case, it's usually about the noise level in the house, in a way that's not me coming down with the wrath hammer, which is like, that's my natural inclination.
Yeah.
That's for me, that was the first thing that I thought, wow,
oh yeah,
I've got to extend mercy, extend grace.
Yeah. I know for me, like, there's so much that pops out in this, like these, I mean, I have to be confronted with this because you guys might not know this out there. I know most of you probably think I'm a sweet puppy dog, but I'm not naturally the nicest person. I should reword that. I have a strong sense of justice, right?
There you go.
And usually for other people. I actually think about myself too, but like, I can so easily just be like, that is wrong.
Yeah.
And you know, I'll give you an example. Apparently, there's something that happens in the genetic code. It has to be from the fall that inhibits some people from being able to put away their shopping cart when they go to the grocery store.
You have that problem too?
I don't have that problem.
No, I mean the reaction.
Seeing it. Yeah, yeah. I don't understand what it is. Some people say it's selfishness, but there's got to be more than that, just the self-centeredness. But that lack of ability to put that out there, and whenever I see that, I think the most awful things. It just immediately, like, it brings me back to thinking about who I am, because I'm also very familiar with my own wickedness, mm-hmm. Which is something, I don't know, I don't want to get in trouble with counselors out there or something, but I don't understand why we run away from this. If you understand God's mercy and grace, there is great liberty and joy found in understanding your deserving, how much you deserve wrath, and understanding how much that I am a punk. Like, I am not a good person. I do not deserve to know who you are. I do not deserve your mercy. I don't deserve this wonderful family. I don't deserve these breaths that are allowing me to, or I don't like this heart that's allowing my blood pressure to get up when I see that person with the cart. I don't deserve that heart to be beating, right? Right. All those kind of things. And it just pours over that grace and mercy. And you realize you're covered in this. And then in doing that, after I have that moment, I immediately want to extend mercy and grace.
Absolutely.
Because, I mean, what's my alternative, right? And then if you can do it on something as silly as a shopping cart, which hurts my soul to say it's silly, because this is a serious problem, people. Like, vet out the people you're voting for in office and see what they do with their shopping carts. That's how you should be able to guess. But if I can do it in something like that, then when somebody wrongs me, like does something outright wrong to me, mm-hmm. instead of being burdened with bitterness and this idea of righteous indignation and justice, I'm able to transfer it into grace and mercy. And I don't carry that weight, you know? I don't have to have that stress in my life. So that's a big one for me that's so big. Is just, it limits my jerkiness.
Absolutely.
I'm so thankful for it.
Well, it's funny, like something you said really kind of resonated with me, this idea, like we want mercy and justice, or sorry, mercy and grace for ourselves. And we want justice and wrath for everyone else.
That's exactly right.
Right? And so recognizing what God has done for us should help us flip our perspective. Mm. And I think you look at so many of Jesus's parables are about,
oh man, yeah,
the way people interact with each other and extending mercy. So the Good Samaritan, yeah. right? who was the true neighbor, right? The guy who had mercy, the guy who had compassion.
Yeah.
You look at Peter's question of, well, if I forgive my brother 70 times 7, is that enough? Mm-hmm. Nope. He says 7 times. Anyway, Jesus says 70 times 7. Continuing forgiveness is an expression of mercy.
Yeah.
So continuing to express that to other people, you have, the servant who was forgiven his debt and then went and harassed another servant who owed him way less.
Mm.
And so you have all these stories that Jesus is telling about how we're meant to take what God has given to us and extend it to others. And
yeah.
I think that's what Paul meant when he said that love can cover a multitude of sins, right?
Mm.
So we love one another well when we express mercy and grace to one another.
Yeah, that's a funny thing to think about too, like digging into. I want to stay on that for a minute. You think about strength, power, being in the expression of justice, being in the expression of vindication, or we want something to be made right, and we esteem that. And I get that. God is a God of righteousness, and that is the reason that's there is reflective of who he is. We just manipulate it. But the strength and power that is in somebody that extends mercy and grace, that is, I mean, that's next level kind of stuff. And the reason I want to think about sitting on that, and it kind of rolls into the idea of what we're talking about. We'll say, how do these attributes help us to spread God's fame and make disciples of Jesus Christ? I think immediately within the body of Christ.
Oh, absolutely.
How many relationships between supposed brothers and sisters? So think those words are used for a reason. We're not talking friends.
All right.
We're talking
family.
Family. Blood-bought family. But how many relationships will we let slide because that person wronged me? And until they're willing to fess up or forgive, ask for forgiveness in the way that I expect to do it, I'm going to hold on to this. And how does that work out for you? That bitterness? I don't know. I just refuse to be bitter. I spent so much time doing it when I was a kid. I got no time left for it. But I think about just what you're missing out on and the liberation that you get by extending mercy and be like, you know what? I'm going to forgive you.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying be foolish. Don't go running into hurtful relationships. There's things of such as guardrails and being safe and the rest of the body of Christ to protect you from things like that. But I think we do that. I think we do that with our spouses. I think people do that with their children or other relationships. And I it's not okay to do outside the body of Christ, but there's something that's really, really nasty about it.
Oh, yeah.
With inside the family,
I had a conversation recently just talking about how when, especially somebody that you have a lot of interaction with, so someone you live with or work with or if you're like us and you're always here, right? So people who you rub elbows with all the time at church, it becomes really easy when you look at people to only see them as the things that have happened, right? So
really good.
So if it's your kid who, never takes the trash out when you tell them to take the trash out, right? And all of a sudden you see that kid in your house, you stop seeing them as a person, as somebody that is bearing God's image, who's a part of your family, and it just becomes about the broken relationship with the, in that case, authority submission, or you said this mean thing about me and it hurt me, and rather than dealing with it, now I'm stewing it. So such a good word, Zach.
It becomes an identifier.
That. Yeah, right? It's how you think about that person instead of thinking of them as just like you at the throne of grace. Hebrews 4, right?
Yeah.
We're all needy beggars at the throne of grace, and yet because of God's favor, we don't struggle to access it.
Yeah.
And so we're in the same place, bro.
Oh, man, that's so good. That's so good to think about. And I hope liberating for people.
Mm-hmm.
And I think so, and that doesn't necessarily have to be a situation just where you are in conflict with somebody else.
Sure.
That should just kind of be the default way you interact with people. So I'm so thankful, and I just thought about this. Nobody's listening, Drew. They tuned in and they saw that it was two guys from the music ministry, and they realized there's no theological value here. There's a couple of fruitcakes up here tonight.
Perfect.
Yeah. But so no pressure. But it occurs to me, thinking about working in the music ministry, and I'm so thankful for, I have some proclivities that could rub people the wrong way, but people extend grace to me and mercy to me because they know me, they know my heart, and they'll often, I think, give me the benefit of the doubt, realizing that I might have said something too quick or whatever, and it was just out of function of, Zach being Zach or whatever.
Right.
But what a grace to me, and I think to them, to be able to allow me to continue to bless them in their life because they don't choose to go anger or whatever. They go, you know, you extend mercy to one another. And then for you, if you just constantly do that as a proactive way, I think that you'll get more nourishment out of this family and you'll enjoy being around us more. And even we've been talking about some unfortunate experiences we've been exposed to with the broader body of Christ and some things we'd rather not see. We'd rather not see people representing the Lord that we do in some public like media and social media and stuff like that. But it makes me think, I really want to get upset about that. And I don't want to belittle that. Like, public defaming of Christ by the body of Christ, that's something to be frustrated about.
Sure.
It's okay to get riled. It's not okay to be a punk about it, right? There's still mercy to be extended in truth. And don't go, oh, I'm going to speak the truth and be a jerk. And then I'm going to turn around and go, but I, you know, I'll extend mercy.
Right. It's always easy to extend mercy after you've gotten your pound of flesh, right?
That's right. It's like, mercy is not, this guy deserves 10 punches, so I'm only going to give him 9.
Right.
You missed the point. But that proactive aspect of grace, like of going, how am I going to interact with this person in such a way that I'm going to show them Christian favor and be able to help them? That's not easy.
No.
But it's worth it, you know?
I'm so glad you said also, like, it's not just about when we have conflict. Because it made me think of the fact, the way that Paul and Peter talk about the gifts of the Spirit, they're gifts of grace.
That's really good.
Right? Yep. And so, like, 1 Peter 4, starting verse 10, he says, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's grace.
Grace, yeah.
And so whoever speaks, you know, speak the oracles of God. Whoever serves, serves in the strength of God. And so it's this idea that even the non-conflict ways that we interact with each other within the church are supposed to be manifestations of God's grace, that we're supposed to build each other up, serve one another, and make this body stronger through God's grace.
So I wonder, this is hot off the press here off the top of my head, so not always the safest thing to say, but as I'm thinking about this and you saying that, would it be fair for us to think if the gifts that you've been given are expressions of God's grace to the body of Christ, and you choose not to function by serving the body, are you hindering, not that God is going to be hindered by you, but are you eliminating your expression of God's grace into the body, right? I think that's implicit there in the text and the concept of you need to be thinking about how you are being a vehicle of administering God's proactive favor to people. I think so many times in the church, sometimes it gets overstated, but I'm realizing more and more, maybe it doesn't get stated enough. You think about the church is, what do I get, right? I come here and do I like this buffet? Like, what am I getting out of it? The irony of it is, of course, you get diddly if you don't do. Like, that's how you get in the body of Christ, is by doing. But I think about, what if you just start with the idea of, how am I here to express God's glory through the unique giftings and ability that he's made me? Not that it draws attention to me, so he gets the glory.
Right.
But how do I do that in the body of Christ? Yeah, I think that maybe we'd have some more dynamic churches, right?
Absolutely.
Across the world.
And I think for, you know, for people who do serve, who are, you know, very active in kind of trying to express that, there's also the sense of not growing weary. And so that reminder that, you know what, this isn't about you and it's not in your power, right? This is God's grace being worked out. And so I think that can help us to not grow weary, because I think there's a, so you have the kind of the temptation on both sides to not participate or to participate to the point of being weary, and both ignore the fact that this is God's grace working out in the body.
Yeah, I think I'll give you, so guys, just so you know, I grew up in an environment where we had testimony. So some of y'all might not be used to that, but we used to have, we'd have testimony service. And you get up and the key is you draw attention to what the Lord's done in your life unto his glory, not to yourself. And I want to draw attention to something, what you're saying, because Drew and I both had to put in a lot of work when we were doing these COVID videos, right? And we were trying to do the services. And there's so many things I would love to talk. If you want to talk to me about something, I'm not super interested in sports or what's going on in the world or whatever anymore, but I would love to talk to you about how many things you don't know about how the Lord blessed us during that time, which were so amazing. But when people would find out like the amount of work we were doing, I think they would be concerned about growing weary. And I think I speak for, we got tired.
Absolutely.
But weariness wasn't part of it, because it was the understanding of God, and God was extending his mercy and his grace like over and over again in that time while we're working to produce these videos. It was almost like a strength. And it wasn't almost, it was a strength beyond us.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Full-fledged tired.
Oh yeah. Yeah. You know, when you're doing the home recording videos and you're on like take 37, yeah. You know, and you're wanting to throw the computer out the window, you know, like that's God's grace to get you yeah. through that as well. But yeah, the fact that, we're able to build up the body, through the work that we do, through the work that so many people do.
Yeah.
And I know some of y'all know, a lot of y'all don't. There's a lot of people at Grace Fellowship who you'll probably never see their faces or names, but they are serving the body in physical ways and spiritual ways, and praying and teaching and making sure that the grass gets cut and making sure that there's coffee in the coffee pots. Yeah. Well,
once toilet paper.
Once COVID's gone, yeah. we'll get coffee back. Yeah. Hopefully.
Do we have the same coffee in the pots from there? I don't, we might need new coffee.
You know, but so much of God's grace is expressed to us through each other. And so not that you know, to draw attention to them so they get a pat on the back, but it's just amazing to see what God does through the body. And so I want to draw attention to the fact that God does that.
Absolutely.
To give us grace.
Yeah. It's not, I mean, it really, if you get those kind of pat on the back moments where you're like, you're really feeling good about yourself, I don't know why you would. Like it's, you're almost like you're robbing yourself of it. It's this idea of feeling that you're a part of something bigger than yourself because you are. And like, it's just this little glimpse of the kingdom, right? Like of what the kingdom will be like. And that in and of itself, being used by God, what a grace and a mercy. I don't deserve this opportunity and privilege. I do deserve to not even be part of this body. I don't even deserve to know this gospel exists, right? And those extensions being done there. I want to think about something really interesting, really important when we talk about how it impacts how we're here working at this church. But our ministry of what we do, we say that we're about spreading God's fame and making disciples of Jesus Christ. And maybe sometimes we don't talk about this enough, but when you're thinking about mercy and grace, how do you think about that without going to the advancement and proclamation of the gospel, right? Like,
I mean,
this is the message.
The message is God's grace, right? Yeah. Ephesians 2, you've been saved by grace through faith, right? And even just what we were just talking about and the result of that. Sorry, I'm skipping verse 9. Not because it's not important. Just anyway, verse 10 says that God has prepared works for us to walk in, and so that is a natural outflow of the grace we've received. But yeah, we need to proclaim to those around us the fact that God is a merciful God, that He's a gracious God, you know, and tell them about justice.
Yeah,
because
it's the
only way grace and mercy makes sense. And to serve our community, I think opens up so many doors for proclaiming the good news of Jesus's kingdom.
Yeah.
So obviously we've got to look for those opportunities, whether it's organized through the church for something like Family Promise, or just being a good neighbor, right?
Yeah.
Everybody I think who lives around here has neighbors, right? There's not a lot of really truly rural anymore. And so just having the mindset of I'm going to extend grace and mercy to the people around me who don't know about the Lord so that they can know about the Lord and experience the grace and mercy. Like it's this cool, this cycle that just keeps happening over and over.
Yeah. I think this is really good to note, like these two concepts. I know people sometimes can struggle with like sharing the gospel and they're not sure if they've got the right things down or they're going to mess it up or they're going to commit heresy and something and trying to testify. Grace and mercy, really, if you got those two concepts down, you've got a lot of what you need to do in telling people because, again, the if you're talking about grace, right, this unmerited favor, it reminds people that you're not entitled to anything. You don't deserve anything. That our account is negative. What we've earned is death, right? Wrath. Mm-hmm. But God will extend His favor unto you freely without anything you've done. And then the idea of mercy and explain to people that you this wrath will come, but it doesn't have to because the Lord poured it out on His Son, right? Mm-hmm. So obviously there's some functional things to get in there, but if you really wrap yourself around those two concepts, you should start feeling pretty comfortable about it. And the good news is, like, these topics have kind of been covered a lot.
So yeah.
If you want to find out stuff about grace and mercy, just read Christian books, the fathers, the, you know, patristics even. Like, this stuff's been talked about for a long time.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Good stuff. Okay, so I think now to get to the burning question. Maverick or Goose?
I don't like Top Gun.
Oh, no! Oh! Yeah, so I will give you a pass, because you're like, 4 or 5 years younger than me?
Yeah.
Okay, so I barely got in, right?
I've seen it a few times. I know all the taglines and everything. It never resonated with me. I loved the video game as a kid.
So I was going to say, Nintendo. Not even Danger Zone. Like, you got to get up for the log, man.
Yeah, I mean, it's like 4 times in the trailer.
Oh, yeah. yeah. Little known fact, you know, Kenny Loggins didn't actually even write that song. That was the composer, and then he just performed it. So the king of soundtracks, one of his best ones, he didn't even write it. So I think I want to say Maverick, but I don't want to be an arrogant jerk. But I think I kind of just wasn't it? But Goose was cool. He got Meg Ryan. I mean, and he dies. So,
yes, and my wife is shaking her head right now because I admitted publicly I don't like Top Gun.
Oh, it's okay. You know, there is grace and mercy, which I even feel silly. I don't want to belittle grace and mercy.
No.
But guys, thank you for joining us, Drew. Thank you. I think it's a lot of fun. Obviously, this is a topic, as they all are, that can go on. This was our last topic for the Running with Joy series. So for now, this will be our last podcast. I would really like to ask people to give us feedback on if you found this important. We can't tell who's listening on the website. We don't currently have a tracker to do that, so we don't really know. But if you could email me through the website, through our forgodsfame.org website.
Yep.
Just let me know if you see me at church. You know, let me know. We'd like to know if this is something that's viable to you, or if there's other ways that we can make adjustments to be more valuable to you. Everybody loves doing them, so we'd be more than happy to.
Yeah, absolutely. We enjoy doing it, but mostly we want to serve you guys.
So thank you for joining us. Until we maybe have another one, we'll see you in the near future. But until then, keep your eyes fixed, your mind focused, and your affection set on our great and glorious God. Thank you very much.